Thank you very much for the kind invitation, and I'm always happy, as you can imagine, to see my friends. Not in reality, unfortunately. We were already talking about nice wine at Gyro's house, so we hopefully can meet all. I invite you all soon there in Mainz. Okay, so I want to talk about magnetic white semi-metals, and this work was done with a few people in my group, I'm happy to share our newest results. So white semi-metals is a kind of new class of materials, and they're related to topological insulators. So you remember topological insulators are the strange materials where the conduction band and the valence band are inverted, because as you see here on the left side, we have the conduction band and the valence band of a compound, and we have this overlapping region. And depending from the symmetry of the material, we can open up a band gap, and we have a topological insulator who is insulating in the bike and has this very strange topological protected surface states because of this band inversion, which you see here by the dips in the electronic structure. But depending on the symmetry of the crystal, it can happen that some high symmetry points or less high symmetry points are not allowed to be forbidden, so they stay degenerated. And then depending from the position of this crossing points, we have white semi-metals or Dirac semi-metals, which have this very unique and interesting properties. So in Dirac semi-metals, this crossing point is at a high symmetry point, but in white semi-metal, we find this crossing point more on low symmetry points, so they are much more difficult to find. So we can get a Dirac semi-metal make into a white semi-metal by straining the Dirac semi-metal, so breaking the inversion symmetry, or we can turn a Dirac semi-metal into a white semi-metal by applying a magnetic field. So this is the same way, so we break time reversal symmetry. And so the Dirac points are less interesting than the Y points, because the Y points are kind of magnetic monopoles, and they show many, many more interesting properties than even Dirac semi-metals. And these monopoles are in the bike electronic structure of our crystals. And between this here, our crystal is topological, and we have Fermi arcs as surface states, which are the signature of white semi-metals. So, as I said, so we can turn a Dirac crossing, which is here a 4x degenerated point, into Y crossings. And now you understand, if you see here the spin polarization as color red and blue, how the chirality is coming from the spin of the bands. So, one interesting feature is also that if you break time reversal symmetry, we can turn Dirac semi-metals into Y, but we can also say that every crossing point and every ferromagnet, because we always break time reversal symmetry, is a Y point. So this is really interesting, because I think there's an inflation of Y semi-metals, so you simply have to look, and I know already that there are soon coming out some papers on crossing points around the Fermi energy in some oxides face to face in nature. So you can still get high impact papers by looking for ferromagnetic Y crossing. So every crossing point, if it's at the Fermi energy, is a Y point. So as you can imagine, so my main interest is in Häusler compounds, and they're also magnetic. They're ferromagnets, especially the full Häusler compounds. And here you see me and Gerhard Fächer, all the Mainz people know him. He's still working in my team, making new Häusler compounds. And you can imagine in the family of the Häusler compounds, you find also easily this ferromagnetic white semi-metals. And I simply remind you, so especially spin X and all the initiatives in Mainz are related to some work which we started already long time ago, Burkhard remembers, on Häusler compounds. So Häusler compounds have this very exciting electronic structure, because if you can make some of them as non-magnetic semiconductors which have magic electron numbers, and if you add more electrons, then you can make them half metallic ferromagnets, which means they are metallic in one spin direction and have a gap in the other spin direction. And they follow very often simple counting electron rules, like you see here. These are all the half metallic cobalt 2 Häusler compound, and you simply count the valence electrons, like here cobalt 2, titanium, aluminium. I talk to the spintronic community, therefore I think I don't have to spend too much time here, has 25 valence electrons. So we have the 24 electrons for filling up this band and one additional electron, which makes this magnetism one we bore. And so you can make even more, like here you see the whole row. And they have quite high TCs, and therefore they are also interesting in the context of application like cobalt 2, iron, silicon, for example, 1200K. So now you can imagine looking for the simple feature crossings in the band structure, and everybody knows spaghetti band structures and crossing. It was very clear that shortly after vials were discussed, André Brunnevik and others recognized that in the, here's a full relativistic calculation of cobalt 2 titanium germanium with 26 valence electrons, that they have crossing points around the Fermi energy. So that, this was the first prediction, but unfortunately, if you look here at the Fermi energy at zero, the crossing points are slightly above. So this was not the ideal material for looking for these crossing points. Therefore, people got excited, but then shortly later, less excited. And if we want to investigate the transport properties of these white semi-metals, we do more or less the same what people do in spintronics. Since a long time, we measure the Hall effect. And we know we can measure the normal Hall effect in a semiconductor, but I don't have to explain this here in length. If we have a ferromagnet, we measure the so-called anomalous Hall effect. Because of the magnetism of the material, we have this additional contribution due to the internal magnetism of the material, and we can measure the anomalous Hall effect in ferromagnetic materials. And I don't want to talk about the spin Hall effect today in this context. Okay, so then when André predicted cobalt 2 titanium, tin and germanium and so on, so we remembered that we did some very nice work with Jürgen Kübler a long time ago on looking for the anomalous Hall effect and the Berry curvature in the band structure of all different Häusler compounds. And there we recognized that we can find very large anomalous Hall effect in materials which have crossing points close to the Fermi energy. Here you see the example cobalt to manganese aluminium from this publication in 2012, where you find this crossing point around the Fermi energy. And the calculation, the Berry curvature calculation, gave a very high value of the anomalous Hall effect, and the measured value was also very high. So this was measured in Gerhard Jakob's group. So Matthias, you know them. So in 2011, and the explanation with the Berry curvature came shortly after this, and there's even a nice patent from this group from this time. And then if you look for the Y points, you see a very nice Y point. It has really the shape as you want for a while. Cone, but you see also peak in the Berry phase. This is a Berry phase, the Hall conductivity in this material. So it's something which was more or less known, but not in the context of topology, because the people didn't directly connect this large anomalous Hall effect with this crossing points. At this time, we mentioned this, but we didn't see the topology behind it. So in general, and this are papers now which explains the theoretical background in general. So if you have these crossing points or nodal lines in this material, so this always leads to a large Berry curvature in the electronic structure. And this leads to an anomalous Hall conductivity on top, even to an anomalous Nernst conductivity. So this is a nice feature now, which still we could do much more. And I encourage young people to do maybe more and look for materials which might be even very, very interesting for energy conversion and this application and anomalous Hall effect eventually for Hall sensors. So coming back to cobalt 2 manganese gallium, we didn't publish the anomalous Hall effect because this was published in 2012, but then we recognized we have to do it, otherwise other people do it. And you see here this very nice curve, the anomalous Hall conductivity as a function of the magnetic field, and it has this very large jump here, which is one of the largest. And then you can even calculate the Hall angle if you see that the charge carrier concentration is not so super high in the Häusler. So the Hall angle is quite large, up to 12%. And now people even find in cobalt to manganese aluminium 25%. So we expect in the Hall angle of 100% for the quantum effect. So we are really close to the quantum effect, and this is all measured at room temperature and might be higher even at higher temperature. So compared to other Häusler compounds and other even topological materials, so cobalt to manganese aluminium and cobalt manganese gallium shows a very large anomalous Hall effect. And we think now using this feature, looking for crossing points in the band structure, this is only the tip of the iceberg. There's a lot still to do. Okay, so seeing that whether, so here's the spintronic community. So I have to say, so in spintronics, people look very, very carefully on the anomalous Hall effect because there are extrinsic parts and intrinsic parts. So the Häuslers here, our Häusler films and single crystals, they show nicely the behavior you expect for the intrinsic part, berry phase. So you can look for the temperature dependent and then you can extract this intrinsic part from the extrinsic part, and less extrinsic parts play a role. But this is because of this large enhancement due to the berry phase. So cobalt to manganese gallium has ferromagnetic nodal lines if it's not magnetized, because it's a soft magnetic material, as you can see here. It's a cubic structure. It's X, Y, Z are the same direction. And then if you apply a magnetic field in a certain direction, you can nicely show these nodal lines into Y points. And the first thing what we do always in topology is we do uppers to verify whether the calculated electronic structure is really the right one. And this we did nicely together with Hassan's group, and he showed really the nodal line in cobalt to manganese gallium. You can here see this this photo emission data around the Fermi energy, slightly even how it goes along the high symmetry direction. And the prediction was also that you find a very unusual surface state, a drumhead state, and this is what was then also shown in Engel-Rosoff photo emission. So the anomalous Hall effect was known from 2011 from the work of the Mainz group, but the anomalous Nernst effect was not investigated until now. So we measured the anomalous Nernst effect, and this was also a giant effect compared to what was known before. So it's the largest effect so far, as you can see here. So it's like the value is 8. So here, so if you compare it then with the and you see, so even it goes up still, we assume we cannot measure to high temperatures so far to TC, because normally this is experienced and Nernst effect is the largest around TC, and then it drops to zero. The anomalous part of the Nernst effect, so this is the step. And then if you draw this Nernst effect in microvolt per Kelvin versus the magnetization, you see that all these interesting topological materials like cobalt to manganese gallium is much higher than all the common materials which are known and so on, because of this additional contribution to the berry phase. So there's another class of materials which has drawn the also our interest. This are these Kagome lattice, and the reason is that you saw here manganese 3 tin, and we worked on this. This is a hexane version of a Häusler compound. So this is a big group of materials which has this very special arrangement of 3D metals in a Kagome arrangement. And in 2018, the group of Shakelsky found out that this leads to very special band structures, this Kagome lattice, which has its crossing points here, the Dirac points in iron 3 tin 2. But we had another compound which we were interested in, and it has the same kind of lattice, cobalt 3 tin 2 sulfide 2. And the reason why we made it is cobalt 2 manganese aluminium is soft magnetic. Iron 3 tin 2 has the spins more or less in the plane, and this compound has a nice out-of-plane magnetization, and we thought this is much more interesting. So we can maybe see the features, the topological features, even in a zero field, because we can magnetize the compound and investigate interesting properties there. So this is a compound. You have this Kagome lattice of cobalt here, and then tin and sulfide. It's quasi two-dimensional under the viewpoint of magnetism, but it's very difficult to cleave because you have some bonding between tin and sulfide here. So the band structure looked also very promising. What you can see here, it's again crossing, every crossing, and there are not so many bands around the Fermi energy in this compound. So, and they have very nice crossing also here around the Fermi energy. So, and this is due to Y points in the band structure. So you can have here the nodal lines, you see the nodal lines, and then if you don't apply magnetic field, and then if you apply magnetic field, you have the Y points. But the nice thing, as I said, is because the compound is ferro-hard magnetic, it's much easier to investigate. And thanks to the referees, they forced us to do the other experiment to prove that something is a Y semi-metal, to prove the chiral anomaly, which means this is another important feature, so that you have, if you have the magnetic field and the current in the same direction, so you should have a negative magnetic resistance here, B parallel E. And if they are perpendicular to each other, you have positive magnetic resistance, which goes with the square of the magnetization. So, and this was a feature which we really found in this compound because it has a simple band structure. And then the prediction was that we have this interesting surface state, this Fermi arcs, which were much larger in this ferromagnetic wild semi-metals than in other semi-metals. And this is what then was calculated by Bin Hai, I think, and Jan Sun at this time, and Julian Chen has measured it with APIS. You see here also nicely the surface states in this material. And we could also see the surface state at two termination, tin and sulfide, by STM's investigation from Heim-Weidenkopf. So the Y points were slightly above the Fermi energy in this compound. So you see, these are the APIS data, and we had to dope it a little bit with potassium to see the Y crossing really below the Fermi energy. So also this compound here, cobalt 3, tin 2, sulfide 2, is in the intrinsic area of the Berry phase. So it's also mainly determined by the intrinsic anomalous Hall effect. And you see here, it's a nice hysteresis. So because also in the Hall measurement, because the material shows this nice out of plane magnetization. But you see also that TC is only of around 150 Kelvin. So for a real application, it's maybe not the ideal material. Anyways, the compound shows a really large anomalous Hall effect because here we have especially also a very low charge carrier concentration in the semi-metals. So if you see here, especially around 100 K, we have an anomalous Hall angle of 20%. At lower temperature, there's a non-collinear spin structure, might be interesting for skirmions in this compound. Therefore, we have here this drop. And you see again, if you see the Hall angle versus the Hall conductivity, you see this is behaves different from what we know from normal magnetic compounds. So also here, the anomalous Nernst effect is large, similar like in cobalt 2 manganese gallium. So it seems to be that this feature works. Look for crossing in the band structure. You see a large anomalous Hall effect and an anomalous Nernst effect. And here also, you see already this very nice Nernst effect, even in a zero field because of the magnetization of this compound. And again, here also looking for the Nernst effect as a function of magnetization, you see they are much higher than what you expect from normal magnetic materials. So at the end of the day, we want to find quantum effect. And the quantum anomalous Hall effect is a prominent effect which we are looking for. So we want to see really for spintronics. I think it would be the dream of all people in spintronics, including, I think, Matthias and so on. So if you could have a poor spin current, and the idea is if you measure Hall in a magnetic material, so one of the spin direction gets suppressed if you apply magnetic field and you get a poor spin current. So it would be nice to see this. And this was already seen in chromium doped bismuth tellurium, so in the topological insulators doped with a ferromagnetic metal. But it's also seen nowadays in the manganese tellurium, bismuth tellurium compound. So there are already evidence at low temperature for this quantum anomalous Hall effect, but spintronics wants to do it at room temperature, so there's still the need for looking for materials. So we thought, can we make cobalt 3, tin 2, sulfide 2, or this kind of materials to be showing a quantum anomalous Hall effect? And indeed, if you assume you have a white semi-metal and then you make it thinner, monolayer or thin film, then you indeed turn a white semi-metal into a quantum anomalous Hall effect. You see exactly the quantization in this material. And this is here a calculation with the edge state for the real material. And do we see evidence? We think yes, we are fighting still with the referees. So if we take this cobalt 3 tin 2 sulfide 2 single crystal, we see at the cobalt edges interesting chiral edge stages, which is predicted from topology. And so if we then do SDM measurement, and this is done in Vidya's group, so they see really a quantization depending on the bias voltage of this material. And we think we see evidence that one layer of this material is quantized. Unfortunately, we were not able so far to make a mono layer as a thin film. It's not our expertise, but this might be an interesting direction to go. So also theory would support this. So if you, as I said before, if you have a white semi-metal, you have a staple of three you have a 3D quantum Hall effect, and if they are connected, so you don't see really a quantum Hall effect. But if you can disconnect these layers, if it would be really two-dimensional material, so you can turn your white semi-metal, sorry, into a quantum anomalous Hall system if you remove the Y points from each other. And we see the thing that we have a kind of 2D material in the cobalt 3 tin 2 sulfide 2 because the electron density, there's one additional electron which keeps it away from being a semiconductor, and it's really localized in the cobalt layers, the spin and the electron density. And we think therefore the value is close per layer is close to one in this compound. So if you calculate the thickness of your crystal and so on, you can calculate that the value of the anomalous Hall effect is close to one to the quantization per layer. So this is shown here that you really, I have to say we did the logarithmic scale, so it's not perfectly. Anyway, so for the last minute, it's like then you can think, I don't want to make a cobalt 3 tin 2 sulfide 2 famous, so we want to find it in Häusler compound. Can we make Häusler more two-dimensional? And there are relatives of the Häusler compounds where you can simply empty one layer of cobalt, for example, here in cobalt 2 manganese aluminium, every second layer you can empty, then you come to the so-called PBFCL structure, and then you can make a compound like manganese, aluminium, germanium, which is then a more 2D magnetic material, and we made this material, and indeed there we have also the charge density and the spin density in one layer, and the distance between the magnetic layers eventually big enough, and we see also that the Berry curvature in this material is very two-dimensional, like the materials. We have crossing points close to the Fermi energy, a large Berry phase. And we see also that we have per layer of manganese here, nearly a quantized value in the anomalous Hall effect. So maybe there's more behind this, this big idea of us. And I'm sure this is maybe a direction which we can do in spintronics, thinking about magnetic oxides, magnetic Häuslers, magnetic materials, which might be interesting for quantum anomalous Hall effect at higher temperature. So this is my vision. And with this, I come to the end. I know it was a fast talk, but I want to spread this idea to the spintronics community that we really should look more for Berry phase design, because this comes from spintronics, and now it's very popular in topology. So to make maybe quantum anomalous Hall effect at room temperature and devices like Majoranas, despite of spintronics, maybe something for quantum computing. But I showed you also that even the Nernst effect might be interesting. There was this nice paper from Nakazuchi. The values were even slightly lower than in Häusler's, I have to say, where he claims that he can dope iron to be energy efficient as a Nernst effect. With this, I thank you very much for your attention, and I hope I have a nice life. Yes, and I thank my co-workers and my group for their nice work. Thank you very much.